Since the start of the Russian invasion of Ukraine, the threat of nuclear war has been as real as it's been in decades. After all, with Russian forces getting hammered each day in Ukraine, it's no wonder that Putin's getting pushed closer and closer to pressing that nuclear button. With a nuclear Armageddon potentially imminent, how many nuclear weapons could the US feasibly shoot down? Before we delve into how the US can shoot down an ICBM carrying a nuclear warhead, it's important to understand the basics of ballistic missile defense. What makes a ballistic missile is both its range and speed. You can break down ballistic missiles into short range, medium range, long range, and intercontinental ballistic missiles. Additionally, most short range and some medium range ballistic missiles can be considered subsonic, which means they travel slower than the speed of sound. Most ballistic missiles are supersonic, meaning they're faster than the speed of sound. What makes an ICBM so special is its ability to travel extreme distances with heavy payloads. With countries like Russia and China claiming their best ICBMs can travel almost 20,000 kilometers. These are some pretty heavy and serious weapon systems. These missiles are also extremely fast, traveling upwards of 10 to 20 times the speed of sound. Because of their weight, speed, and carrying capacity, most nuclear warheads are affixed to ICBMs. Though some countries like Russia have other ballistic missiles with nuclear warheads, most threats the US would face would be ICBMs. Whenever a ballistic missile launches, its flight path is broken down into three phases. The first phase is known as the boost phase. This phase consists of when the rocket is fired and as it begins gathering enough speed before transitioning to the next phase of flight. The next phase is called the mid-course phase. The mid-course phase is the part of the flight path where ballistic missiles travel on a relatively steady plane. It's during this phase that the missile travels the bulk of the distance toward its target. Once the missile reaches the end of the mid-course phase, it transitions to the terminal phase. In the terminal phase, the missile turns over from its mid-course portion to barrel down on its target. With the help of Earth's gravity, the missile speed peaks during this portion of the flight. It's also during this part of the missile's flight that it deploys its multiple independent reentry vehicles, or MIRVs. Regarding ballistic missile defense, the best time to hit a missile is during its mid-course phase. During this time, the missile is the most exposed it'll ever be, and its relatively flat trajectory gives any target nation the best chance it'll have to shoot it down. Because the mid-course phase guarantees the highest probability of a kill, most US systems are geared toward taking the missile out during this part. However, over the past 30 years, countries like Russia, China, and North Korea have been developing countermeasures to prevent a successful shoot-down during the missile's most vulnerable phase. Creating missiles that can weave during flight, or pre-programming ICBMs to fly to parts of the Earth where no US radars can cover, like the poles, makes relying on shooting down ICBMs during the mid-course phase alone tricky. Another complicating matter is the radar's ability to track ICBMs accurately to guide interceptors to the target. Because most of the interceptor missiles do not have their own active radar, they must rely upon sea or ground-based radar systems to help track the target. This is why the Navy developed the Aegis Combat System to help provide that coverage. Initially rolled out in the early 1980s, as part of the Ticonderoga-class cruiser program, Aegis was and remains today a state-of-the-art system. Aegis itself is a combined hardware and software system that integrates the weapons and sensors of US destroyers and cruisers into one combat suite. By aggregating data into one place, Aegis serves as a literal one-stop-shop defense system both for the ship, other nearby ships, and for land-based objectives. The heart of the Aegis system is the SPY radar, and SPY remains the best air defense radar on the planet to this day. While its exact parameters remain classified, there are some basic functions that SPY is great at that helps US ships complete their ballistic missile defense mission. One of the main reasons that SPY is so great is the frequency band it operates in. Choosing the right frequency is essential to BMD missions. If you choose a frequency that's too low, you'll not get enough fidelity to get a coherent and accurate track. If you select a frequency that is too high, then the range on the radar suffers greatly. Through decades of testing and development, the US has perfected the frequency range for air defense radars. Another factor US planners had to consider for Aegis, and any other fire control radar for that matter, is radar cross-section. Radar cross-section, or RCS, is the part of an inbound contact that reflects directed radar energy and can be seen on the screen of the operator's console. All military operations aim to minimize RCS as much as possible. Navy ships, Air Force stealth aircraft, and missiles aim to make the RCS almost non-existent to prevent them from showing up on enemy radar. Because of this, fire control radars must be able to pick up on the smallest RCS, which the US has done well with both its sea and shore-based radar systems. Regarding the BMD mission for the Navy, The U.S. currently has about 48 destroyers, nearly half of its current inventory, as BMD-capable ships. What makes these ships so special is they have better Aegis baselines than other ships in the Navy, because of all the variations of Aegis that have developed over the years. As new threats appear and new developments in software and hardware are discovered, newer versions of Aegis get installed on Navy ships. The weapon that the Navy uses to take out ballistic missile threats is the Standard Missile 3. The SM-3 is a relatively new weapon in the Navy's inventory, reaching operational capacity in 2014. The SM-3 was the U.S. attempt at creating a dedicated ballistic missile interceptor instead of just using a modified SM-2 missile with new software that made it an SM-2 Block 4. With a dedicated interceptor, the Navy is poised to operate almost anywhere in the world as a viable BMD platform. Since the spy radar and Mark 99 fire control radar are all internal to the ship, the Navy can create a wide net for BMD coverage. Though the exact capabilities of the SM-3 remain classified, a highly publicized test from 2020 proved that the Navy could shoot down ICBMs with Aegis. On November 17, 2020, at a remote U.S. testing facility in the Pacific, a destroyer successfully intercepted a live ballistic missile target with a live SM-3 missile. The destroyer also did this while simultaneously tracking other inbound air contacts. The test achieved a perfect 1-for-1 kill ratio and was realistic, since in an actual war, a ship would be tracking other inbound air threats. While the test might have been successful, it's the only test the public has been made aware of, and the shootdown was just for one ICBM. In a real scenario, there might be dozens or hundreds of inbound nukes. Because of this, U.S. planners understand the need for shore-based interceptors and have installed them both in the U.S. and abroad. Abroad, the U.S. has two Aegis Shore commands in Romania and Poland, and these facilities are armed with 24 SM-3 missiles each. Should Russia ever try to shoot nukes at Europe and the U.S. be denied access to places like the Black Sea, Baltic Sea, and the Mediterranean, the U.S. will still have a viable option to shoot those threats down. For protecting the homeland, the U.S. has two more systems, both of which are owned by the Army, with some Air Force support. The primary homeland defense system is the Ground-Based Mid-Course Defense System. As the name would apply, the GMD system is designed to attack inbound threats during its vulnerable mid-course phase. First designed in the late 90s, by the early 2000s, GMD had reached operational capability. Deployed at Fort Greely, Alaska, and Vandenberg Space Force Base in California, the two units work with the Air Force, which provides overall command and control for the system. Essentially, GMD operates the same way Aegis does. It comprises of a series of ground-based and sea-based radars that provide targeting data. The Air Force aggregates this data and feeds it to both bases in the event of a nuclear attack. Once received, either base could fire one of 44 of its ground-based interceptors. These massive rockets are designed to launch an exo-atmospheric kill vehicle, or an EKV, that actually takes out the ICBM. Using a variety of computers and color sensors, the EKV guides itself to the target after being launched from the GBI. Utilizing brute kinetic force, it rams itself into the incoming missile to destroy it. Because of this, the GBI does not use a conventional explosive warhead. Though early developments of the GMD were promising, their overall success rate has proven to be lackluster. Of all the 24 or so tests conducted, GMD has about a 52% chance of a kill using just one missile. However, that kill percentage goes up to a 97% chance when firing four or more missiles. The services have taken steps to improve the system's accuracy over the years. In 2014 and 2018, the Air Force built impressive radar arrays in Alaska and Hawaii, respectively. These arrays have greatly improved the range and coverage of the GMD system to provide accurate fire control solutions. Another drawback of the GMD system is the fact that there is no East Coast base site. Congress has funded studies of an East Coast site, and the military came back with using Fort Drum in upstate New York as the best possible site. However, the military said as of 2019, there was no operational requirement for it, so the East Coast site remains abandoned for now. Perhaps, with everything heating up in Russia, Congress will order the military to construct a new one. The last viable homeland defense system the military can field is THAAD. Short for Terminal High Altitude Area Defense, THAAD was first developed in the mid-2000s and first reached operational capacity by 2008. Currently, there are 7 THAAD batteries in the U.S. inventory, all operated by the U.S. Army, with 5 presently stationed in Texas, 1 in Guam, and 1 in South Korea. These units consist of their own internal radars, fire control computers, launchers, and other equipment. Because these are totally self-contained units, they can easily be moved around. While they might take several hours to several days to be fully set up, these can be placed anywhere in the U.S. for point defense of an area. Similar to Aegis and GMD, THAAD also employs a kinetic warhead to destroy incoming targets. But unlike Aegis and GMD, THAAD has a much more limited range. Sort of like Patriot missiles, but for ICBMs, these batteries are limited in their range by their own organic sensors. But despite having a limited range, THAAD remains the only viable option the US has in its current inventory to destroy ICBMs in its terminal phase, potentially. I say potentially because THAAD has been successfully tested in shooting down a range of ballistic missiles, but it has not completed a publicly known intercept of an ICBM. As far as determining how many nuclear weapons the US could shoot down, that's a pretty tough question to answer. The US Navy currently has about 500 SM-3 missiles in its inventory, and the Army has just 44 GBIs available for launch in the GMD system. As for THAAD, each battery has 6 launchers with 8 missiles each. That math comes out to about 900 total interceptors the US could hope to throw at an incoming ICBM. Now, in a real-world scenario, other systems like Patriot missile batteries would probably be used, but these were never meant to take on ICBMs. However, it's possible the military would employ them in a last-ditch effort. But for this calculation, we'll leave them out. These are also publicly identified figures, so the US may have more of these in storage or in production that's unknown now. But for argument's sake, with a grand total of 900 interceptors, a 1-for-1 kill ratio would be 900 nukes. However, as previously stated, it's essential to note that almost no weapon system has a 1-for-1 ratio due to factors like frequency, RCS, and defeating countermeasures. Taking the tests for the GMD into account, in a worst-case scenario, needing 4 missiles for each ICBM would mean the US could take out just 225 nukes on its worst day. So there you have it. If Russia were to ever get crazy enough to fire nukes at the US today, the military could take out between 225 to 900 nukes.